sight and sound of real steam. Food for nostalgia. Oh, may I introduce myself? I'm Bob Symes. What can you do if you don't live near a preserved railway, or for that matter, are able to join one? The answer's simple. You build a model railway. How do you go about it? It's easy. You either buy kits or make things yourself, and you need tools, paintbrushes, and lots of patience to make the skeleton upon which your imagination can hang the nostalgia. So why not join me for the next 50 minutes or so to have a Lineside look at what I consider some of this country's finest model railways.
Look at me, I'm a train on the track, I'm a train, I'm a train, I'm a chugga train, yeah. Look at me, got a load on my back, I'm a train, I'm a train, I'm a chugga train, yeah. Look at me, I'm going somewhere, I'm a train, I'm a train, I'm a chugga train, yeah. Train, I'm a chicken train, yeah. Been hard days, it has been hard days, it has been hard days, it has been a chicken train, I'm a chicken train, I'm a chicken train, I'm a chicken train, chicken train, yeah.
Magnificent. The Model Railway Club's superb 2mm scale layout, Chiltern Green. It's amazing what model railways will teach you. They'll teach you how to handle equipment, woodworking, electrical, filing. You'll even learn how to handle a soldering iron without continuously either burning yourself or burning holes in your clothes. It's quite remarkable. And there are model railways for all types and kinds, all pockets, all homes and all gardens. The biggest one is gauge one. That one is really ideal. That comes either bought or made. I make my own, but this is one that has been bought. And that is absolutely superb for the garden.
Ready to go?
Building a railway in the garden is probably the best way of capturing the atmosphere, especially if you're going for live steam. So you've got the sound, the smell, the whole lot. It really feels good, and speed with the LMS Scott. And then you can go in for the most powerful engine in this country, a Bear Garrett. Everything really comes to life in the garden. And then, of course, my own child. And there she is. This is mine. All mine. Homemade. Well, almost completely, because the body is commercial. But the inside was made by some friends of mine and myself. And it's radio-controlled. It works really well. So anything you like, you can go in for in gauge one. Running a smaller scale garden railway is Jeff Bigmore's cup of tea. Jeff started his layout, Bigston, in 1946 to a scale of 7mm to the foot. That's O gauge. It's L-shaped, running end to end. The line is electrically run on the two rail system. The operating practice follows the LNER routine as it was from 1926 to 1936. Leaving Bigston is an ex-Great Northern Atlantic hauling a Pullman Car Express bound for Westbridge at the other end of the line. Although Jeff enjoys running his layout, his main interest is scratch building locomotives. Each one takes him 6 to 8 months to make. Among his collection is a B-17 Class 460 Tottenham Hotspur. And here is an old North Eastern Railway Tennant 240. But pride of the line is Captain Cuttle. This is an LNER Gresley Pacific, which worked mainline expresses right up to the end of steam in the mid-60s. Heading from Westbridge to Bigston and climbing the 1 in 40 gradient past Archway is an ex-Great Northern 080 hauling a mineral train. These locomotives were known by the train crews as Long Toms because, well, they were rather long. But garden railways can also be successful in the smaller scales and to the slimmer purses. Proof that 00 gauge works well out of doors is Brian Birchall's Daventry Garden Railway. Virtually the whole of his garden has been given up to the layout with something like 1,000 foot of track. Brian had so much interest for his layout from over the fence that he now runs open days in aid of charity.
Welcome to Daventry Garden Railway.
Obviously, the scale between the railway and the flowers and shrubs is totally out of proportion. But remember, your mind has very flexible scales. All the locomotives and rolling stock are 16.5mm gauge off the shelf and ready to run. And even after 10 years of operation, the whole layout performs remarkably well. Brian's layout is at ground level. The track base is constructed of concrete sections, and between each section, a gap's left to allow for the expansion. The concrete also carries plastic tubing used for cables and drainage. The track itself is laid on a foam rubber underlay and pinned to hardwood strips which have been set in the concrete. I had a very enjoyable visit with Brian, and of course, the perennial question just had to crop up.
What happens when it rains?
Well, it gets wet, and we simply run it.
Well, you can't be more logical than that. And obviously, the whole concept of the garden layout works well for the Daventry Garden Railway. And undeniably, the combination of weathered rock, heather, and small shrubs, ponds, and waterfalls make a very picturesque setting. Well, from garden railways to indoor railways, with Tim Watson giving us some of the backgrounds to the Model Railway Club's 2mm scale layout, Chiltern Green.
It's far too long, so we've got to miss out a bit between the viaduct and the station. And similarly, if we're going to be producing...
The group that I was involved with started looking around for a suitable area to model, and an area which seemed most suitable for our purposes is just south of Luton in Bedfordshire. And so this area, Chiltern Green, was surveyed. We had a sort of field trip up to the area, took some photographs, and started digging out maps, old Ordnance Survey maps of the area, and researching it as much as possible. The layout itself, it was decided that we would try to produce a model which showed the railway running through the countryside rather than the usual scene, which is railway and no countryside, so that it looked as if a whole lot had been engineered through the rolling South Bedfordshire Downs. And so the layout had to be planned carefully with that in mind, bearing in mind also that we didn't have a limitless amount of space and that there would be a need for a lot of compression in certain areas of the layout. However, it is still recognisable as Chiltern Green, and you know, a good many people have sort of said, well, you know, I live just down the road from there, or I went through those crossing gates when they were closed against me at some time, or this sort of thing. And so the model has certainly proved that it is possible to make a good model of an area Which is recognisable even if it has been slightly compressed here and there. A lot of the items on it are in fact good, accurate copies of the real thing. And to that end, we were fortunate in getting copies of the original contract drawings from British Rail for the viaducts on the layout. The model is primarily an exhibition layout. It was designed with a view to showing to members of the public at model railway exhibitions up and down the country. And to this end, we designed it so that there would be plenty of operational activity on the layout. So that there is a four-track main line, which is a Midland main line from St Pancras up to the Midlands. And so with four tracks, you've got expresses, you've got slow goods trains, and you have a lot of movement on those lines. In contrast, we felt that the addition of a branch on the front of the layout, the old Dunstable to Hatfield branch of the Great Northern Railway, would make a rather sort of bucolic, slow, ambling little railway to sort of compare with the hustle and bustle of the main line. And so the model comprises two aspects which are not often seen in a model railway, which is a heavily engineered, a large main line and a rather small little branch line. The scenery on the layout, well, that was taken from the locality or from any buildings which we felt suitable in Bedfordshire.
We'll have to have a little look at the buildings and the photograph there. You can see the mainline station and the cottages. Now, the cottages there have got to be taken out because I think we're not going to have room for them. And we'll have to take out a bit of land between the mainline station and the farm, and the farm and the branch line station. And the branch line station will be correct at the front here.
I come from a farming family, and so that is something which really does interest me a lot, getting the atmosphere of a farmyard and the neighbouring outbuildings and so on. And so I try to sort of bring in as much as I can remember and as much as I know of farming into the models of the farm and the fields and so on.
The exhibition scene provides many model makers with the incentive to provide really interesting layouts. So let's now look at Barry Norman's Windlesham Cove and Mike Hayward's Chesil Bay.
Well, Chesil Bay represents a typical Southern Railway branch line. It's set somewhere along the Dorset coast. The layout itself's about 17 feet long, and I've made it so that it splits down into four sections, each about 4 foot long. They can then be bolted together and form a box. So you've got two boxes, and put those into an estate car or van and take them off to exhibitions. In making Chesil Bay, I've had to carry out a fair amount of research. I found that the London South Western Railway had at one time intended producing a line going on from Dorchester across to Exeter along the south coast. And I've based the layout as what might have been a branch line off that particular line. The buildings on the layout are from the sort of Southampton area, and so that they're all of a similar style. At the left-hand end of the layout, there's the station building. That's based on Totten Station. And then next to it is the parcels office, which is based on Moreton Station. In the background, there's the engine shed. And as you go further along the line, you can see that you've got the bay platform, the main platform of the loop, and then the line from the goods yard joins and goes past the signal box, which is based on Forley, and then there's a signal gantry by the side of the signal box, which will control the movements of the trains into the station. So that's really the basis of the layout. The control panel has been designed so that the whole layout can be operated from one place. It's also been made so that it can be operated from either side, either from behind the scenery, as it would be at exhibitions, or from in front when I'm running it at home. The points and the uncouplers and the signals are all controlled from it. There's simple push buttons, so the operation of the push buttons will move the points, will work the uncouplers, or will work the signals. And so from this control panel, I control all the trains as they come in, as they run round and move out. In order to try and bring the layout to life, there's lots of little details around. Well, the initial thing, obviously, is the people. You need to have people around to use the trains. And these I tend to try and group in what would be sort of informal groups, little groups of people talking to each other, standing by notice boards, or just generally gazing across in the scenery. As the railway is moving, the locos are moving, it's impossible, obviously, to get the people to move, so you don't want them to look as though they're in a moving scene, but they're static. The cars, again, I've tried to generally put them around in what might be static areas in car parks, although there are a few around in the road. So you've got all these added details to put in. You've got also the fencing around the buildings. That makes the particular type of railway would use a particular type of fencing, so you've got to get that correct. And all these things, I believe, sort of bring the station to life. It gives it a little bit of character, and it makes it a little bit more individual. And you can have quite a bit of fun of setting up little scenes up and down the layout. It gives people at exhibitions something to look at.
During the programme, you'll notice one or two interesting variations of fiddle yards. This is Barry Norman's version on his layout, Windlesham Cove. Like Mike Hayward's Chesil Bay, Windlesham Cove is also a portable layout and is well known on the exhibition circuit. Again, it's based on Southern Railway practice and is built to 4mm scale running on EM gauge, that's 18.2mm track.
Leaving Waterloo Station about 60 years ago, changing trains at Bournemouth, you might eventually arrive at a small seaside town for your holiday like Windlesham Cove. Windlesham Cove aimed to be one of those typical southern stations at the end of a long winding branch line that led down to the sea. Unfortunately, when I started looking at the different branches like Lyme Regis, Swanage, Seaton, Sidmouth, they're all quite different, all quite unique, so it wasn't really possible to build a typical station, so I selected the Swanage branch to build my model. Really, the whole station is a mixture of the two stations on the Swanage branch, Swanage itself and Cough Castle. The station building here is a model of the one at Cough Castle, very similar, slightly altered to fit into the arrangement here, whereas the engine shed, water tower arrangement at the other end is based upon that at Axminster, although not built in the brick that the Axminster one was, but in the local Purbeck stone of the Swanage area. Quite an unusual arrangement, with the engine shed running off the turntable, with the water tower and coaling stage just in front of it. The goods shed arrangement is virtually a copy of the shed at Cough Castle, with a small cattle dock at the side, the typical goods shed, with this ivy growing up the side that was very typical of photographs of the shed throughout the 1930s and 40s. The station area has been built up as a group. At the front, the station buildings with a canopy, and you might notice that the whole building is painted in the style of the London South Western Railway, which would have built the branch line. This setting is in the early 1920s, just as the London South Western Railway became the Southern Railway. So the buildings are still in the livery of the London South Western Railway, whereas the locomotives, carriages are those of the Southern Railway. As you notice, the canopy, every individual piece of wood is painted a slightly different shade, little detail that made things look a bit more interesting. To finish the scene, there was a background of trees here. I tried to make the trees copy of real ones. Some are oak, some are ash. There's one or two silver birches at the other end, but it's to give a backcloth to the whole general area. In front of the station area, contrasting with the station building, is the brick-built office with the coal staith just outside where the local coalman would have unloaded his coal and taken it to the inhabitants in the town. Again, it's another group here. The Foden steam wagon, introduced into the 1920s, will be taking parcels, crates, off to shops, perhaps factories in the area. Up at the other end, there's two road bridges. One of them comes from Swanage, that was positioned at the station just behind the goods shed originally, and the other one comes from miles away in Cornwall. As the line continues through the road bridge, you come upon the level crossing. There's a pair of typical London Southwestern railway gates and the signal box that controls and comes from Wiltshire. Being a Southern Railway branch line, it's not surprising that most of the engines come from that company or the original London Southwestern Railway. We have the Beatty Well tank, an engine built originally in the 1860s but rebuilt many times over the coming years, and they mainly worked in Cornwall, so it's a bit out of place here. We have a Great Western engine over there, metro tank, called a metro tank because it ran mainly in the metropolitan areas of London, but were seen in later years out on branch lines. It's not really very common for Great Western trains to run into southern stations. It seems to be a model maker's dream, really. With a couple more southern engines here, a Jubilee class tender engine, called a Jubilee because it was introduced in the Jubilee year of Queen Victoria. And the last engine, the Adams radial tank, originally would have run in London, but in later years progressed into the branch lines and became very well known for running on the Lyme Regis branch in Dorset. Whittleston Co. was started a number of years ago, and gradually, of course, over the years, ideas develop, new things come along, new ideas, and I felt it was time to start on something new. And this is Petherick. It's a landscape, the idea being of a station set in its natural surroundings with rising hills, bridges, cornfields, making it look as real as possible, losing the outside edge of the baseboard, but making it feel absolutely real. It obviously uses the techniques that I've used before, but they've been extended, developed, hopefully improved upon as the years have gone by. There's still much detail to put on this model that make it far more interesting, areas of interest, small bits of detail, and of course, one of the main areas are trees.
Barry Norman touched on the subject of trees, and in a little while we shall have a look at Shirley Rowe actually making trees. But before that, let's have a look at another way of making an interesting and colourful background to layouts. Shirley's husband Dave has a great passion for scenic modelling as a setting for his trams and narrow gauge lines. Dave and Shirley work closely as a team on their dioramas, and both have a very keen eye for detail, which probably accounts for the tremendous interest their models create wherever they are seen. Axford has taken Dave 3 years and 5,000 hours of skilled work to create. I first met Dave at an exhibition, and it's obvious that he's a man of infinite care and patience. Just look at the detail here. It's so fine, it's unbelievable. Dave admits that sometimes he even has to use his own hair as a modeling medium because it is just the right scale.
What I like to see in a model is not just the railway, but also the community that it serves. And here, I've taken a variety of buildings from various locations in East Devon and assembled them into one composite town through which the River Axe runs in the far corner, and hence the name Axford. Around this part of the world we have Axminster and Axmouth, and now to that I've added this town of Axford. Over here, a whole row of shops from Honiton High Street, all the interiors of the shops being modelled in great detail. A over in the corner behind the street market scene, I've taken shops from Sidmouth, while on this side of the road is a completely different section of Ottery St. Mary. Here in the backyard of this shop, we have the handcart belonging to the local chimney sweep, and in it you can see some of his spare sweeping rods. He's not visible, he's inside the shop, but if you look at the chimney here, you'll see his brush emerge as he does his work. Over here I have put the street market, which takes place on Thursdays in Axminster, copying each stall, even to the extent of reproducing the vegetables and fruit in the exact positions that they have them on their stalls. Trams run down the length of the high street to give added interest, while trains run along the front here. The school here is a little village school to the north-east of Honiton, and this was about the most difficult building of all, about 250 hours in this building. There's a basic plywood base with plastic sheeting cut out to form the walls, and to that I've applied modelling clay, which is marked up into the shapes of these various stones. The area down here has a little coaling stage and a group of workmen who are busily engaged in some problem, while next door is the station master's new bicycle. This comes complete with bell, brake levers, reflector, pump, and even two spokes which I've formed from my own hair, gluing them in place one at a time.
The trees which I make are made from this steel cable, which is available from garages. It consists of six main strands, which have to be untwined, and then each of the six consists of 20 smaller strands, which again have to be untwined using pliers because the cable's very, very stiff. The big divisions represent the branches, and then the smaller divisions represent the twigs, which have to be cut at varying lengths to give a more realistic appearance. When the whole bundle has been untwined, it appears something like this one. And at this stage, it has to be coated with a mixture of plaster and powder paint. The powder paint is added to the plaster so that if the tree gets chipped at any time, it doesn't show as glaring white, but it comes through as a browny grey colour. This is applied fairly liberally to cover all the twists of the wire. And of course that takes quite a while to dry. But when it dries, it appears something like this one. And at this stage, it has to be scraped off to give a smooth bark, or it can be left as this one is for a rough bark. And when that's done, it has to be painted. This was sprayed with a grey-green oil paint, and then the foliage has to be applied. The foliage is sold in a mat which is quite solid, and this has to be teased out as finely as possible to give the leaves the natural light, airy appearance that they have. And the pieces are just draped on the end of the twigs, secured with a little wood glue. And the finished tree appears something like these.
There's a tendency amongst all of us to make our trees far too small for our layout. You don't realize it, but a tree, a pine or an oak, for a 4 millimeter scale layout, has to be 12 inches. That's nearly 30 centimeters in height. Much, much bigger than you think. And coming back to layouts, Martin Brent has some very positive ideas of how to build them.
My model of Rye Harbour is based very much on the East Sussex scene. I've stretched the area perhaps a bit to take in a bit of the coastline around Rye. And I've built a railway that runs from Rye down to the sea. In fact, it bears little or no relationship to the real area. But in the model, I've incorporated several features from perhaps my past or that are personal to me, things that I remember. In the harbour area, there are some net sheds that the fishermen used to hang their nets to dry in before the days of man-made materials. There's a little boatyard that I used to have to visit in the course of my job. I had to have a pub on the layout, but the actual area available was rather small. Eventually, I used my mother's house as a basis for the model, but called it after the pub that I used to regard as my local. This type of thing gives a layout life and makes it more interesting. There's more to a model than just the actual railway. There's the landscape around it. One of the things I do feel is that you should be able to look at a station, a model of a station, with no trains there, and be able to say, that's Sussex, or that's Devon, or you should be able to place the model by its surroundings. If you're going to build buildings that look like the real thing, then you can't just get a sheet of card and start cutting. You've got to look at the real houses, the stations, and find out how they were built and base your models on prototypes. It's all too easy to build a house from your imagination and then find that it is completely impossible and it looks wrong. All of the structures on my layouts are based on prototypes from East Sussex. When I go around the country, I take a camera with me and perhaps a sketch pad as well. If I see a building I like, I'll stop, take a couple of photographs and store it away for a rainy day. And then when I'm building a layout, perhaps I might be able to incorporate either a complete building or some features of a building. It's the actual enjoyment you get from creating something that is very personal. I've incorporated in my model of Rye Harbour a lot of personal touches. Perhaps a touch of vanity is the photographer by the level crossing, which is meant to be me, because around the time of the model, I was in that part of the country photographing railways for all I was worth, because they were going to disappear. And it was something that I was going to miss.
Once again, Rye Harbour is a very popular layout at exhibitions. And Martin is very cunning, creating little scenes, little slices of life to create an atmosphere.
If we take this track gang as an example, normally they'd be engaged in repairing the track along here. But because they can't move, we can't run trains round them. My answer was to assume a landslip had occurred on the embankment here. We put a 5 mile an hour speed restriction there, and here we have the gang busily engaged in repairing the landslip. Even mistakes can be turned to one's advantage. Here, I spilt a drop of paint when putting the boat shed in. Rather than try and wipe it out, I extended the paint so that it looked as if oil was leaking from the barrel.
Well, Frank Dyer's Borchester Market is an extensive 4 millimeter scale layout running on 16.5 millimeter gauge. It's based on British Rail Eastern Region practice in the late 50s. And every inch of the 10 by 13 foot layout is packed with interest. Frank is an inveterate showman, and he likes nothing better than to go to exhibitions. And there he makes sure that Borchester Market is run exactly as the prototype.
Now, this is an entirely imaginary place, but it's set in a real enough location, some 10 miles to the northwest of Newark, rather on the edge of the Dukeries country. It's not on a main line, it's on a line which, in fact, nearly did get built in reality in the 1880s. And, of course, its reason for its existence was coal. The railway itself represents, of course, part of the line. You can't represent a complete railway because a railway is a thing very much of length. So I represent the terminus station of this town, Borchester, and a little bit of the line disappearing through tunnels in the hills. If you were standing beside a railway line watching the trains, that is what you would see. You'd see a little bit of railway line, perhaps a quarter of a mile in either direction. That's all you'd see. The trains come into it from somewhere and they disappear to somewhere. This is what I try to show, the train watching scene. But as regards the actual movement of the trains, the way they run, how a railway operates, we try to reproduce this as accurately as we know how. On a real railway, especially at a busy station, a watcher would notice that a lot of things can happen at the same time. And very often you get many completely independent movements taking place on different lines, interweaving of movements very often. For this reason, we work to a pretty complicated schedule. And we have three operators that work on the station here, and we can make at least three movements at any one time. This is not easy. There's very little automatic. It's nearly all done with manual controls, requiring great concentration on the part of the operators. This is deliberate because when you have to concentrate on doing a job properly like this, this is when you achieve the maximum of fun and interest out of it. Now, there's a lot more in running one train than just a single movement. In fact, it is a complete story. Let's imagine, for instance, that we had an express train running from Borchester Market to London. And so, at the appropriate moment, a little engine, which normally spends its life fussing around the station, pushing coaches here and vans there, brings into the platform a long rake of coaches. Once in the platform, the little engine uncouples. Meanwhile, in the locomotive yard, the engine which is going to take this train to London is being prepared. And at a few minutes before departure time, this locomotive backs onto the train, and attention now focuses on the signal box, which controls all the movements. And before this train can move out, he has got to get permission for it to do so. He's got to make sure that the line is clear. So he communicates to the next signal box up the line. In this case, it's called Wellow East Junction, ringing a special prepared code of bells. The man at Wellow Junction replies back. And what in fact is happening is that the signalman is asking, is the line clear for me to send an express passenger train to Wellow East Junction? First of all, you see the signals across the throat of the station lift, that is, they clear, which means to say the train may proceed. And as the train gathers speed, the signalman signals to the box that the train is on its way. So the departure of one train is quite a story. When you imagine a lot of complicated moves taking place all together at the same time, then you realise that model railing is not only an art, but it's quite a science as well.
So far, we've seen four mill scale layouts running on track gauges of 16.5 and 18.2 millimetres. But now, let's have a look at Dave Lowry's layout. That runs on a prototypical scale track of 18.83 millimetres.
My layout is called Beverley's. It is a small branch line, and it is my interpretation of 1883 modelling. It's my first real attempt at 1883 modelling, and I suppose it's been the result of some 5 years' work. The period it runs from is from about 1910 to 1915. And when I first joined the club, the Amateur Model Railway Society, many years ago, the chairman there was an expert on London Northwestern coaching, and I felt this was an area perhaps I could have a go at to create my own thing. So I chose the London Northwestern. There's no strict prototype for this layout. It basically started off as a test track, which became scenified after a little while. There are many aspects on the layout which I think are very rarely found in a prototype of this size. So it's basically, it's all fictitious. Most of the scenery has a polystyrene base. And once you've laid the track and cut the baseboard to fit it, it's infilled with polystyrene, which is shaped. Polystyrene I then paint green to hide the awful white colour, and from this you can start to contour and create your own scenery. Most of the scenery has a flock base of the various grasses glued down, and this gives you a good working surface.
Yes, Dave's quite right, it does look good. And look at the green grass on the occupation crossing, seldom modelled. A rail motor just pulls into the station. And there it is. There's somebody in the station building. And out goes the rail motor. And straight into the fiddle yard. Mind you, that's something everyone needs, a fiddle yard in a layout. And the smaller the layout, the more important the fiddle yard. He's got three tracks on the traverser. And so all he has to do is wind the handle until he lines up something that he wants to come out from the fiddle yard.
Starting from the traverser end of the layout, you can first of all arrive at the small station. This is only a very small building. In fact, there is quite an absence of buildings on the layout. From the station, you go past the small coaling stage. This is for small locomotives and a water crane. There's a small gate which is opened as a train arrives and departs. At the end of the same road, there is a small cattle dock which is capable of handling two cattle wagons or occasionally has a permanent way wagon at the end. On the opposite side, you have a small siding which handles the coal traffic and also the goods traffic. As we go under the bridge, the stream moves into the small canal basin, and a siding off onto the left there carries some fish, coal, any sort of traffic that side. We then pass through under the next bridge and into the final little halt at the other end.
And finally, in our Lineside look at model railways, we visit Bromford and High Peak. It's a magnificent 7mm O-gauge layout. Bromford and High Peak has been developed in three stages since 1972. Full-length express and freight trains running at scale speeds are a practical proposition on such a large layout, which after all covers an area of 60 by 30 feet. The locomotives and rolling stock are models of prototypes running in the late 1930s. The large area the layout covers is used to good effect, with magnificent bridges, buildings, signals and scenery. The line is based on an imaginary area in the Midlands. High Peak is situated somewhere near Birmingham and is built in the Great Western style. This breakdown train is just passing through the station as the Great Western Parcels train travels in the opposite direction. high peak is on a high level. We'll start below. Provision has been made for running trams. The blending of model scenery into the painted background is very effective, particularly around Langley Holt level crossing. Now, how's that for a control panel? From here, the operator has a clear view of the whole layout and completely controls all his train movements. This through coal train is hauled by a Great Western 7200 Class 282. And speeding along on the embankment behind is a Pullman Car Express hauled by a Southern Railway Merchant Navy Blue Star. In the goods yard at Bromford arrives a local freight train. The station areas are a mass of detail. The buildings and lineside structures follow the LMS practice. Just look at this. What an atmosphere. I can just feel myself walking, or better say, stumbling across that station yard back in the 1930s, amongst all the hustle and bustle of a busy goods depot. Leaving on time, an LMS 440 pulls away with a local passenger train, and in the foreground, the car park full of commuter vehicles. Just look at this, even more detail. The stop me and buy one ice cream man hoping for business, and a bus picking up passengers. As we pass the station master's house, an LNER express hauled by a Class A3 Pacific is coming through. Just look at her, here she is. And in the opposite direction, an LMS Midland Compound 440 working a stopping passenger train, resplendent in its maroon livery. Alongside Bromford Station is a large motive power depot where the line's locomotives are shedded and serviced. And through the station comes a mixed goods train pulled by an LMS Class 8F. What a magnificent 7mm scale layout. An inspiration to all of us, whatever scale we model in. Well, that brings us really to the end of our line-side look at model railways. And all that remains for me to say is thank you for coming to join me. And I hope we'll meet again some other time. Meanwhile, goodbye.